Good afternoon. My name is Adam Balcer, and I'm program director at the College of Eastern Europe. And I have a great pleasure and honor to moderate today's online debate. Maybe I will start with a short introduction of our project and then our distinguished speakers. So this online debate is organized within the framework of the project called Poland and Germany in the East. The third German-Polish roundtable. Within the framework of this project, we have already organized roundtable. It took place in November in Wojnowice, where we have there our small castle, and this place is, in fact, this place serves as our headquarters, and Jan, for instance, was there and took part in this event. We are implementing this project together with our German partners, Deutsch-Russischer Austausch, and we are co-founded by Heinrich Boll Stiftung, their office in Warsaw, and also Foundation for Polish-German Cooperation. Besides this roundtable in Wojnowice, we have already organized three online debates, Ost-Schut, it means East in Polish and German, German-Polish debates on the East. The first one about the US factor in Polish and German Eastern policies. The second one about Eastern flank. We also talked about the Nord Stream 2. And we have recorded four podcasts. We are going also to publish a policy paper. So as you can see, we have a wide scope of various activities within the framework of this project. Today, we are going to have the last to hold the last online debate, which is called Polish and German Perception of the East, Legacies of Culture and History. We decided to pick up, I would say, subject which has more long durée, a long-term perspective, and is also related a little bit to, I would say, even philosophy, epistemology. I mean, what does it mean the East, and about cultural policies of both countries, and so on. And I invited two excellent speakers. The first one is Aleksandra Zinchuk, PhD. Of course, from Lublin, editor-in-chief of Kultura Enter magazine, vice president of the board at Open Territory Foundation in Lublin. Of course, probably you are familiar with the city located in eastern Poland, which is right now a symbol of Polish-Lithuanian-Ukrainian cooperation. And in the past, it was a place that the union between the Grand Duchy of Lithuania and the Kingdom of Poland was signed in 1569, and the Polish-Lithuanian Union transformed into Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. So it's a very important and beautiful town. And she's also a researcher of literature and Eastern European cultural heritage of the borderland, because Lublin is located close to the border with Belarus and Ukraine. She is also initiator of many research cultural projects. She has graduated from Maria Curie Skłodowska University in Lublin, a member of several NGOs and the executive team of Eastern Partnership Culture Congress and Cross-Border Cooperation Congress. So as you can see, you can immediately realize that Aleksandra is very much engaged in the Polish-Ukrainian, Polish-Belarusian cooperation in this border land region. And then we have Jan Behrens, who is head of project at Centrum für Zeithistorische Forschung, Potsdam. Again, a city which is, of course, extremely beautiful. I strongly recommend everyone who has never been to this town to visit it, because it's really gorgeous, and it's also, of course, related to the Eastern Europe because of the legacy of history, its heritage of ties with Eastern Europe and Russia. And he also teaches at Freie Universität Berlin and Humboldt Universität in Berlin, and he published a lot reports, articles, policy papers, and books, and edited and co-edited many books. For instance, the Erfundene Freundschaft, Propaganda for the Soviet Union in Poland and in the DDR, DDR. And in English, for instance, several years ago, he edited a book, The Return to War and Violence, Case Studies on the USSR, Russia and Yugoslavia, 1979-2014. Also, he for instance, edited a book on the anniversary of Red October, Red Revolution, October Revolution. So, definitely, I'm very happy to have on board so such excellent speakers. Of course, I would like to ask you for some kind of compassion and empathy in case of Alexandra, because unfortunately she has COVID and she's recovering, but still she doesn't feel very well. She has some fever, so please take into consideration that maybe she will speak slightly slower and so on, but nevertheless I'm very grateful that she accepted our invitation and she's taking part in our meeting. So I will start really from the scratch. Of course, the Christmas are coming, the end of the year and the beginning of the new year, so sometimes in December, of course, we are very much preoccupied with we have two guys from NGOs and or universities, think tanks. Unfortunately, we have to report a lot to close certain projects and so on, but at the same time that's the moment very often that we are thinking about the future, next year, some plans, and we are bringing into equation a little bit more long-term perspective, a wider horizon. So in that case I would like to start, that's why I decided that the most, you know, this kind of general and a little bit philosophical discussion we'll have in December before the Christmas. And let's start from the scratch and let's try to conceptualize and define what does it mean, this term, the East, which in fact we use very often in Poland and in Germany, in public debates, scholar debates. It's widespread, of course, you can find in internet and also in media in both countries. And very often, in my humble opinion, that's my personal impression, that this term is used without a bigger self-awareness, self-questioning, a critical thinking, a little bit, what does it mean exactly? What kind of meanings are hidden or standing behind this term? And quite often, that's my impression, it is used in negative sense, as some kind of opposition towards the West. We have in Poland, as you know, this strong polarization, and we can say that quite often, in fact, we are orientalizing our adversaries. This Orientalism, this term was coined by Edward Said. That's a very famous book written by him, you know, as probably all of us know this book. And of course, there is a new word, neologism, orientalization, this process of orientalizing, to present someone as a very static and in some kind of essentialist way. That is something that we have, something which is different in the opposition to the West. So definitely, I think that we need this kind of discussion. And that's why I would like to ask you, what, in your opinion, right now for Poles and Germans, what does this term, the East, means? I know that it's not very simple question, that quite often this term is full of contradictions, paradoxes, but nevertheless, let's try to define, conceptualize, what does it mean? So let's start with Alexandra, please, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much for having me here, and I'm sorry that I'm not so smart and brainy today as I would like to be. As for your question, maybe let's begin with a simple fact. When we think East, we keep in back our minds the term of West. While the West for Polish people is still synonymous with wealth, civilization, development, entrepreneurship, progress, liberal and democratic values, then the East is associated with the lack of legal, solid structures, wildness, disorder, deception, tyranny, corruption, mass graves, part of family history on the exile, lost at lands from the imperial time. You mentioned about Edward Said, and he said something very crucial, that imperial ideology always left forever the pattern in our cultural field. On the other hand, Russian Soviet aggression and long occupation, this is all concerns in our society. And I'm entirely agree with you that the connotation of Easternness tends to be negative in our public debate. On the other hand, in the discourse of symbolic elite, I mean among writers, academic and school teachers, even in business sphere, a change can be seen in last decades. But this is the result of many years of informal education, international context of artists, exchanges of researchers, youth exchanges, mobility beyond old closed borders, a new tourist offer to Eastern European countries, cross-border cooperation between local governments. And finally, thanks to civic society and intellectual circles who took a huge effort to promote Polish, Ukrainian, Belarusian, Lithuanian, and so on, culture from both sides. However, somewhere deeply in common consciousness in the world full of mass media, project management with coaching style in every sphere of our life, haste derived from principles of capitalism and accurate proper gestures to be seen, to be accepted, eventually to exist in the modern world, makes these all things make people tired. And in this sense, I can see the East means something positive, especially for creative people, even cool recently, because this is something nearby the nature, nearby authenticism, rural, eco, even spontaneous lifestyle with ordinary people, with the rhythm of everyday life, which is going to disappear one day. Anyway, note that thorny issue when Polish people think badly about East is when we speak about Russia and sometimes about countries in its neighborhood. Maria Janion, as I remember, wrote that the Lithuanian myth is for Polish cultural subconscious a paradise, a lost childhood, in a positive way, in a positive sense. But we have, you mentioned about Union of Lublin, so we remember Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, so we were the empire over the 233 years, while the myth of Ukraine is rather a hell, absorbing failures and disasters. So here the wounds are too fresh, especially after 20th century. Interesting why we more often see East as something bad, not good. Probably because of national complex, victim syndrome, the difficulty in dealing with war trauma, class division, and federal service in this part of Europe, in Poland, and in our lands. The opposition of our mental map between Western and Eastern Europe always has economical and political reasons, so we cannot run away from that opposition, which is strongly rooted in geopolitical concept. So according to the Mackinder's idea, who rules over Eastern Europe rules over the Central Asia area, and finally rules over the world. So there is why we as citizens from Eastern Europe do not to be ruled anymore. So maybe the biggest cost of our complex, not necessarily this national one, but common for Poles, Lithuanians, Ukrainians, Belarusians, and further, Georgians, Armenians, Moldavia people, and so on, who want to be a part of Western independent world. So just to keep in my mind, last translated and published, finally published and translated great books of Larry Wolf. So he also gave us the concept of maybe not East, but Eastern Europe, which is an artificial concept of 18th century, thanks to which was possible to create Galicia province. But I like very much also the answer of Andrzej Stasiuk, whom I asked a few years ago during author meeting, where exactly does East start? And he was wondering for a while, and then he replied, that somewhere where you can see often more people as are in the crouching position than standing one. So this is very nice comparison. Just imagine people in West civilization who are rather crouching on the street, not standing. This is also very interesting. So this is, I think, maybe the style of living. What do you think about it?
Thank you very much, Alexandra. I'm really impressed that even with COVID, your performance is really great. Thank you. Can you, sorry, because there were some technical problems, can you repeat this comparison metaphor between the Western and Eastern Europe and standing on a street? Can you repeat that? Because frankly speaking, I didn't hear that.
I was asking Andrzej Stasiuk a few years ago about exactly where, how he thinks, where the East start. And he was wondering, and then he found out the answer that in that place, when on the landscape, you see more people that are used to crouching on the street, for example, or somewhere in the landscape, then standing. Yeah, so I like this comparison. This is a somehow we can say about the metaphor of the style of living, something where we can feel more freely. Just a concept
okay.
of that.
Thank you. Right now I understood. Jan, okay, so now the floor is yours. Please share with us your position, your opinions. Please, go ahead.
Well, yes, thank you very much, first of all, for having me and for the invitation. And I think it's always very interesting and also enlightening to discuss these sort of questions in a German-Polish comparison, because you understand more about your own nation if you understand how your neighbors think and struggle with similar concepts. And I think it really makes sense to compare these notions of Ost and Vzhod. That said, I think the bad news is maybe that in Germany, it seems to be even more complicated and ambivalent, the whole notion of what Ost might mean. And I think it very much depends on the cultural and historical context that you look at, as a historian, the century, but also the region of Germany. If you're from the Rhineland, then of course, Berlin for you is Osten and the East, right? I mean, Adenauer famously said during the Weimar Republic that civilization ends in Magdeburg at the Elbe River, and everything that comes after that for him was Asian steppe. And and that's why he liked to have the capital in Bonn then after the war. But now we're sort of like back in the East, the Germans. So there are many Easts. That would be my first argument. And of course, there's a traditional German East, which means Eastern Germany, or could mean Eastern Germany, the former GDR. It could mean the lost territories after 45, Silesia, East Prussia, Pomerania, Danzig, Gdańsk, you know, these areas, of course. But then in a broader notion, of course, the East can also mean Slavic Europe, anything that is not Germanic, you know, and it's not so much a geography, but it is really a mental map question, you know, just as Alexander pointed out, you can argue with Larry Wolf, you know, in this sense of Slavic Europe, of course, Prague would be Eastern Europe, although it's west of Berlin and Vienna, actually. But because it's Slavic, it is somehow Eastern Europe, although it's, you know, further to the west geographically. So that is, of course, another traditional notion of East that you have in Germany. Then, I mean, a lot of people, of course, if you talk about Osten, you know, they will think of Ostfront, the Eastern Front. So there will be World War I and World War II. That is, of course, a perception that is still very vivid, also in popular culture and movies and in historical research. Of course, that plays a great role. But what I meant with the ambivalence, I guess, in the German cultural field of the East is that the East may be a promise, a promised land also. You know, there's a strong Russophile tradition from the 18th and 19th century, also Bismarck, you know, as a Russophile, and all this political tradition of close cooperation with Russia and the Russian Empire, mostly against Poland, of course. I don't have to tell you that during the time of Polish partitions. So there, the East is not only something negative, but in this, you know, Imperial German or Prussian view, something to be had and to you know, land also of opportunity. But on the other hand, there's of course this cultural, what one might call a superiority complex of the Germans, where, you know, you would also see the East as a uncultured land, as, you know, a land of disorder, where order has to be brought to in an authoritarian way, maybe most famously in the 19th century novel Soll und Haben by Gustav Freytag, which was a bestseller in Germany for about 100 years, and which had this very negative picture of anything that is, you know, beyond the German border. So I think it, you know, it depends very much on where you're located, when you're talking, who's speaking. All of this we have to ask to understand, you know, what concept of Ost is actually employed here. And, you know, maybe in the rest of the discussion we can talk about, you know, the many changes after 1945. And I think, again, after 1991, this concept changed very much.
Thank you. In fact, we can smoothly, because I don't want to focus so much on history. I'm much more interested in legacy of cultural heritage and history and so on right now, currently. So, in fact, both of you are based in towns which have some kind of allure, attraction to people from the Eastern Europe, not only, of course, Russia, but in Ukraine, Belarus, and so on. And definitely, there is a lot of discussion and presence of this topic of their, for instance, contribution of these immigrants, diasporas to economic life of our countries and so on. But I would like to talk about culture and their contribution to culture of especially maybe let's treat Berlin and Lublin or Poznan as some kind of case studies. And please tell me, how do you see the contribution of the people who are originally from the Eastern Europe to cultural life of your cities and your countries? And maybe also how these topics related to the Eastern Europe, culture of Eastern Europe, sometimes which is in fact rediscovered is present in cultural life of your city. So may please, Alexandra.
So before Lublin, decided to have its own cultural strategy based on multicultural legacy. Of course, this image about you are talking about, of course, it was changeable, and this is, it is changeable, it is irregular, and the same with the onset. So it really depends on which, from which points we are looking at that. But when we are talking about special case study, Lublin has also the great multi-ethnical heritage, but like, you know, I'm also from the small hometown from eastern part of Poland, and rather we need more years and time to discover that heritage and to...
Sorry for interrupting you, Aleksandra. Tell us, please, because I know that you are from Vlodava. Can this you tell us a little bit about, because, for instance, our German or international foreign viewers, they don't have to be very much familiar with this place, which is, in fact, quite interesting. Please.
Sure, I'm sorry. Of course, this is, was kind of short of mine. I came from a borderland between Belarus, Ukraine, and Poland. This is near the Bug River, Włodawa in Lubelskie Województwo, but there is also really typical shtetl before before one and two, the Second World War, and the place of Holocaust, because nearby there is Sobibor, so the, you know, the one of the biggest camp and the place of death of many Jews, also from and mostly from Austria, from German region as well. And well, the point is that also in our eastern part of Poland, we need time to leave the complex of this ethnic multicultural heritage and to build new narration about minorities. And it is not so easy. And Lublin is a good place, but in fact, we have big diasporas right now. When the war on the eastern part of Ukraine started, we had more and more Ukrainians right now, but right now the same is with the Belarusian community. But still, Lublin is the place of transition. We are on the borderland. We are not so big city. So the culture is the main strategy to develop our local community. And it's really visible in last decade how also people who came from Ukraine and Belarus create the cultural program here. But I also remember that in late 90s, thanks to Professor Osadczuk, Bohdan Osadczuk, the great prominent person for Polish-Ukrainian dialogue, there was situated there was established the College of Polish and Ukrainian Universities. We have also Central Institution of Central Europe. We have many organizations, NGOs, and also local governments strongly cooperate with twin towns. We have 45 twin towns, but 25 of them, we got agreement signed about partnership. So this is all is very crucial, important to build again our story about Lublin as a good place and with hostile style, let's say. But still, I think that the good experience we had, it was because of Eastern Partnership program, and thanks to cross-border cooperation program Polish-Belarus-Ukraine, so we manage organize many trans-border, cross-border projects, also participating leaders from Belarusian, Ukrainian, as well Lithuanian side. So this is a good practice to give the floor, to give the space to others to understand and to work together.
Thank you very much, Alexandra. I think that you mentioned that sometimes we have to, I think, show certain personalities, prominent personalities, who in fact unites us, Poles, Germans, Ukrainians, and one of them is definitely Bogdan Osadczuk, who we commemorated the 100th anniversary of his birthday last year, and this year we also we are commemorating the 10th anniversary of his death. And of course he was a prominent professor, scholar, who is also is very important for us, for the college. Nevertheless, he lived for a very long time in Berlin, and he that's why he was, I think, one of the most recognizable Ukrainian experts, scholars in Germany during his life. So, Jan, please, can you tell us a little bit, because that's my impression. I'm working right now. I'm finalizing together with Tim Bosse from the DRA our policy paper. And of course, we are, for instance, writing about Belarus, and that definitely Belarusian diaspora, because of mass democratic protests, this awakening, national democratic awakening of the Belarusian society, they are much more visible in Germany, especially in Berlin. So please share us with us your thoughts regarding diasporas from the Eastern Europe in Berlin and in Germany.
Yes, well, thank you. Well, I think, you know, of course, Berlin is a bit different from Lublin, just because it's bigger and there are people from all over the world. So maybe you have to look a little bit more for the East Europeans. Traditionally, you know, from the time after the Russian Revolution already, there were certain neighborhoods like Charlottenburg, which were very famous for having lots of Russians, mm-hmm. or people from the Russian Empire. They weren't necessarily all ethnic Russians, but perceived as Russians then by the Berliners. And of course, after 1991, if we talk about the last 30 years, Berlin is not only a post-communist city, of course, with East Berlin, but it's also in many ways a post-Soviet city, because it has taken from the very beginning, from 1991, 1992, many migrants from the former Soviet Union. You know, 80% of the Berlin Jewish community is from the former Soviet Union. You know, there wouldn't be such a big Jewish community in Berlin if it wasn't for these migrants. So, you know, there you have one very prominent diaspora group, which has changed through the fall of the Soviet Union completely. But you also have like writers in Berlin who write in German, who are very successful, who were born in the former USSR, for example, Vladimir Kamina, you know, who writes like more like funny essayistic stories, but also very serious writers like Katya Petrovskaya, who was born in Kiev, Jewish Ukrainian writer, who's very successful with her novels about her family history and so on. So they are totally part of the cultural sphere in Germany. You know, the new conductor of the Berlin Philharmonic, and certainly the Berlin Philharmonic is, you know, the big pride of the city, you know, world's best orchestra, whatever you think if that's true or not, is now being conducted by Kirill Petrenko, born in Omsk, of a Russian Jewish family. So there you have very, very prominent actors, you know, of course, from the post-Soviet sphere. On the other hand, you have to say, you know, for me as someone who professionally works in Eastern Europe, if you go to, and I did go last summer, to the protests against Lukashenko regime, you will see that there are a lot of Belarusians, you know, a couple of hundred sometimes if they mobilize, or if you go to the, in the winter, we went to the pro-Navalny protest. There were a couple of thousand even people in front of the Russian embassy. But there aren't that many Germans actually that show up, you know, and the people who do show up, they're like mostly professionally interested. They're historians or sociologists, social scientists who deal with Eastern Europe. So this is also interesting because if you compare it to my childhood, you know, you just had the anniversary of Stan Vojeni. And I remember that the church where my parents went to would send parcels to Poland, food during Stan Vojeni, for example. So there was, and my family had nothing to do with Eastern Europe or Poland or anything. Not that we organized it, but you know what I'm trying to say is that back then, during the Cold War, there was a bigger mobilization that reached just like very normal West German society in this solidarity with Solidarność, if you will. But nowadays, I don't really see that, and I'm not quite sure why that is. You know, it was the same in 2014 with the Maidan protests. There were also protests in Berlin, but it was very much Ukrainians, some Russians who were showing up in solidarity, some Poles and so on. But it didn't really reach so much the German mainstream, if you will. So, you know, so it's a mixed picture, I think. You know, you have some very prominent examples like Petrenko, who are certainly success stories of integration and you know, making a career coming from the post-Soviet space. But then you have also a certain notion of isolation within the metropolis. You know, not everybody really cares so much about Lukashenko or Navalny or so on. That's more, it seems to me, like a minority thing that doesn't really reach so much the ordinary Berliner at this point. But that's just my impression.
Thank you, Jan. I think that we can smoothly move to my next question, which is, in fact, is intertwining the external and internal dimension, namely cultural diplomacy of Poland and Germany. And in that case, allow me to share with you also my impressions, which are based on some research that we are conducting with Tim. For instance, that was quite interesting that when we were researching opinion poll surveys in both countries, Poland and Germany respectively, it is quite interesting that in Poland, to a certain degree, because of obvious reasons, because we are neighbors, you can find quite many opinion polls, results of surveys dedicated, for example, to attitude of Poles towards Ukrainians or Belarusians, and Russians, of course. And in case of Germany, of course, there are some polls on Russia, Russians, Putin, and so on. But in case of Belarus or Ukraine, really, we can say that they are almost non-existent. And generally, still, of course, I have this impression also, Tim, that the awareness of countries located between Poland and Russia, namely Ukraine and Belarus, is definitely on the rise in Germany. Something positive is going on. Especially because of these developments, as that you, Tim, have already mentioned, the war in Ukraine and also mass democratic protests in Belarus and so on. But nevertheless, still there is a huge room for improvement. And it's related, I think, also to even such that Poland should be proud to a certain degree of that fact that we host a very huge, for instance, student communities enrolled at our universities from Ukraine and Belarus. In case of Ukraine, something like 40,000 people. Yeah, it's a really huge number. By comparison, in Germany, it's less than 10,000. of Ukrainians. And of course, Lublin is probably the city that proportionally to the size of population and size of student community, that's the largest, that's the city with the largest concentration of Ukrainian students. So definitely, I think that there is a huge room of improvement regarding cultural diplomacy, for example, of Germany towards Eastern Europe, Belarus and Ukraine. But we, in case of Poland, I think that still there is untapped potential regarding our, and we can criticize certain things. So I would like to ask firstly, Aleksandra, to share with us your evaluation, assessment. What are our successes, I mean Polish successes, but also failures, weak and strong points related to the soft power, our cultural diplomacy regarding Eastern neighbors. Please, Aleksandra.
I mentioned about projects which was made because of these good programs, but it's still, we have problem because we don't know how to sustain the effects and the program of cross-border cooperation program Polish-Belarus-Ukraine is really under the question right now. I can give you the latest experience. My experience is we were finishing right now the project with Belarusian organization, which was forced to be closed. So we made everything what we wanted to do in the small project, micro project. It was dedicated to the road of Polish-Belarusian borderland area, dedicated to fortress of Brest Fortress. And we did 7 information plaques, and we also with our leader, it is very important that the leader of the project was Belarusian foundation from Brest, and they also invented mobile application, and right now everything is standing and waiting for the war, for opening borders again. So this is a big question right now. And this is also, it will happen for next months and years, that we don't know how to cooperate again. But the success is that really we did a lot of great things with people from Belarus and as well with Ukrainians. And sorry for mentioning cultural diplomacy, which is literature, but this is my the closest experience, and I feel that also with you, I mean the Collegium, the College of New Eastern Europe, with Czarne, with even with Pogranicze Insane, with even with Polish publishing house right now, or Warstwy. The workshops of culture institution and edition, we did a lot in this cultural diplomacy because of translating and publishing our neighbors. Great philosophers, thinkers, writers. Among them, there is Mikoła Rabczuk, for example, Oleksandr Bojchenko, Andrei Lubka, and many, many others. So this is very crucial to see and promote other, in our society, other cultures through the greatest thing, so the big cultural impact, because they have something to say and it's worthy to read them. So I think this is a good opportunity to think in that direction, that these people, this nation should be printed, should be translated. And of course, literature, this is only the narrow part for someone who is really interested in, but we are still organizing many extra events, more popular, like concerts, like visual arts, youth exchanges. So this is all only some reason to continue right now, and this is the most important and crucial right now, as I think, to sustain our previous contacts, networks, and build new alliances, which is very hard in pandemic times, and we cannot forget about that.
Thank you very much, Alexandra. Your message is very clear that really culture matters, is very important, and it's a pillar, a key pillar of soft power of each country, and we should know much better every country, and we should know much better our neighbors, and that they can, we can learn something from them. And right now I would like to ask Jan to maybe say a few words about your opinion on German is soft power in the Eastern Europe. And definitely, as I said, for instance, about German Belarusian or German Ukrainian relations, definitely, in my opinion, still there is a huge potential, and especially for Germany to increase knowledge of these countries in Germany, and also ties between societies, German, Ukrainian, and Belarusian. Please, Jan.
Well, Adam, yes, I agree. I see it very much in the same way. But if you look at it from the German perspective, then I think it's like a slow process of normalization. And again, if you start in the 1990s after the fall of communism, you know, it would have been very exotic for most Germans, for example, to be quite honest, to go on vacation to Poland. I'm like, why would I go there, right? That's a poor country or something like that. And but now it's completely normal for people to go to Krakow and see how beautiful it is, to, you know, go to the Baltic Sea and so on. And this sort of process, or, you know, go to Prague and go to Slovakia, and all these places have become completely normal places, like going to Spain or Italy, or right. And this sort of process we also need, of course, for places like Belarus and Ukraine. But it's also going to be a slow process. It's not going to happen overnight. And it needs all of our help and commitment to the process. I mean, for example, in Berlin, when the Maidan came in 2014, the community of people who work on Eastern Europe, that there was no place where you could study Ukrainian in Berlin, that there were usually no history or Ukrainian culture or literature seminars anywhere at any of the 4, 5, 6 major universities in the region. And so what we did is we founded an organization which is called Prisma Ukraina, which tried to, you know, bring people together and organize these sort of things. And I'm not saying that everything got better after 2014, but at least if you want to, you know, study Ukrainian history or Ukrainian culture in Berlin, there's much more than before 2014. And there, of course, from the German perspective, again, it's also about overcoming these strong bilateral relationships. I mean, there have always been people in Germany who work on Poland, and there have always been people who work on Russia. But Ukraine, for example, has always been this black hole, more or less. And Belarus, people don't even know that it exists. Well, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but I'm sorry. To be quite honest, I had colleagues who asked me, is Belarus really this country that comes like after Warsaw? Isn't there something in between? They basically thought it was in Siberia or somewhere. I'm like, no, I mean, you know, from Warsaw, it's like a 2-hour drive maximum, right? So, you know, what I'm saying is, you know, of course, there's a lot of Larry Wolf and essentializing the East left. And but I also think that people were very impressed by people like Ms. Tichanowskaya. I was at her lecture in Berlin about 3 or 4 weeks ago. And a lot of people showed up, and I think, you know, from the Berlin more like intellectual and political class, and people were genuinely impressed by what she had to say, how she said it, and what her fight is all about. So things are changing, but they're changing slowly, And of course, we need all the traditional instruments of cultural diplomacy, like Goethe Institute and Humboldt Foundation and all these things. But we also need, of course, the engagement of each and every one of us, you know, from the community. But I think a lot of this normalization, I mean, again, if you look at the German-Polish case, doesn't come through government or not even NGO initiatives, but a lot of the normalization, I think, is tourism, quite frankly, is business. I mean, so many people in Germany now, because Poland is such a big trading partner, go to Poland just strictly on business first. And then they discover, oh, it's actually quite a nice place. I can come there with my family and go there on vacation. And I think this is, of course, the much more normal way. And this will be very difficult for obvious reasons at this point with Belarus. But with Ukraine, I'm much more, for example, positive about it, you know, because I think there will be more contacts. And it might start with the Volkswagens and BMWs, but then something else also comes out of this even. So I think we shouldn't neglect this. We shouldn't think it's all about, you know, reading Ukrainian literature, and which is all fine and should happen, and discovering, you know, Ukrainian culture and so on. But it's also about, I think, you know, at least from a Central European perspective, about normalizing just going to these countries, going on tourism to Lviv or, you know, to all these beautiful places. But at the same time, I mean, there will always be, to spoil it a little bit, there will always be a certain disappointment, because I think for a long time these relationships will remain asymmetrical. What I mean with this is that there will be more people interested in Germany and Ukraine than the other way around, right? But I think we also have to learn to live with these asymmetries that will exist, you know. I mean, and they exist even in Eastern Europe, you know, to be honest. I mean, more people in Germany are interested in French culture than French people are interested in German culture, right? And still we manage to have somehow quite friendly relationship, you know, although most French people are not so excited about discovering German literature or food or anything, you know, as the other way around. And of course, these asymmetries will also be there in the relationships with the East, and we have to learn to deal with them. And we have to see that, you know, that there will be, or we have to limit the damage, I think, also that comes from other sources. For example, you know, if I talk about history as a historian, of course, from the history wars, for example, that go on, or memory wars, or whatever you want to call them, within the region, because, you know, you can also see that a lot of work that has been done over decades can be destroyed by a couple of government campaigns in a very short time, and create a lot of bitter feelings where there were actually quite good relationships. So let's face it, also this exists also in the region, and this also needs, you know, our voices to speak up when we see that history is being used for things where it shouldn't be used, or culture. Because all of this, of course, we will also witness. And we also see, quite frankly, the destruction of old relationships. I mean, we had in Potsdam a very good working relationship with many colleagues in Russia. And after 2014, this has pretty much died down, broken down, for various reasons. The main reason, of course, being the repressions in Russia, and it's not attractive for our Russian colleagues to work with us anymore. You know, it's not an asset for them to have it on their website that they're cooperating with Potsdam or Berlin. You know, that's not how you make a career in Putin's Russia right now. So it's also the question, you know, how do we help these people? Can we invite them here? Because, you know, these projects that we used to have, where we would visit each other, I think this has come to an end, actually, for now. Not forever, hopefully, but it doesn't seem to look like a productive way anymore. And you know, so in a sad way, we also have to think about formats again, like in the Cold War, where we invite people from the East to come here, from Belarus, from Russia, because, you know, Poland and Germany are the places where they can actually work freely. And that's also part of the story, I think. And I think there should be more opportunities for them to come. I think there are more in Poland. German politics or politicians certainly have to, you know, the new government might be more inclined to actually create programs also for these colleagues who have lost their jobs, who have been in prison, who have run into trouble or who will run into trouble. This is a big whole new field of cultural and real diplomacy, of soft power for the European Union that needs to be tackled.
Can I add something?
Yes, please.
Because Jan, remember that when I was listening to you, I just found out that there is a big thing to do. And I'm really unhappy that it's really hard to organize that. This is a simple thing and don't need much money for that. I mean, a psychological help for people who came, especially now from Belarus. And it's really, really hard to arrange that, not for students, because for students we have it on our universities, but I mean for these people who are repressed. This is a very simple thing, but we can also think how to do it together and get some good examples, maybe from good practice from different fields, countries and cities. I miss it in Lublin. And one thing you mentioned about NGOs, so also this is the crucial thing, because essential is funding for NGOs must be provided. And right now in Lublin we have a really bad situation for that moment, so we don't have money to have some to organize projects which could be arranged by NGOs, not in this mainstream political, let's say, tendency.
Thank you, Alexandra. For right now, maybe I will open discussion to our viewers. There is a chat I'm sorry, I'm back. So, okay, can you hear me? Yes?
Yes, of course.
Yes, sorry. Everything's sorry. Fine again. You left us.
Yeah, I was expelled. Like, in fact, Jan has already mentioned problems right now in cooperation with Russian partners that they face, unfortunately, serious challenges. And also our organizations, for instance, our partners, the ARA, in fact, they were expelled from Russia, unfortunately. That's the reality right now, these days. I would like right now to ask maybe our viewers to raise some questions, comments, and so on. You can do it through chat, which is open to your questions and so on, because we have also viewers who are watching us on Facebook and on YouTube, and there also you can make some comments, but my colleague who is managing everything will let me know about these questions. So if you have any questions, comments, please join us. In the meantime, because there is, I'm not seeing any questions right now. I will maybe ask you, and on my, in my case, it's going to be on my side. It's going to be the last my own question. Is because in this particular project, definitely we are interested in making Polish and German perspectives and for policies closer, creating some kind of approximation of our positions in order to find some common grounds, common positions, to decrease tensions, the divergences between us. We generally trying to find some synergies. So definitely also we always are very grateful for some recommendations of our part, our speakers, participants of our events. And in that case, I would like maybe to ask you, what in your opinion, Poland and Germany, what can we do together in the Eastern Europe in this particular field, namely cultural diplomacy? Maybe you have, let's think maybe in some innovative way, out of the box, your ideas, please. Jan or Aleksandra, up to you, who would like to pick up this question first.
Aleksandra?
Okay, so maybe it won't be very innovative, but really need to be done. So some maybe new round table or think tank, international think tank with people from Germany, Poland, Ukrainian, Lithuanian, and so on. And there are still some historical thorny issues which always divide us. And if we leave everything in the hands of politicians, we won't ever overcome some difficulties. So it will be great to... We are talking about our great past, imperial one in Poland, about Polish, Lithuanian Commonwealth, but we are not writing books about Lithuanian history or very, very narrow at universities, because we were only writing about Poland. We are not talking about Ukrainian nationalists. We won't change much in our society if people are only watching TV or Volinia by Smarzowski movie. If we do not discuss more about Volinia, Galicia crime, about 38 year and where the Orthodox churches were destroyed by Polish government, when we won't say more about Action Vistula and so on. So, but also the Great Famine and the Great Terror, which is also the common history and experience for more than only for one nation. So if we have more research on that difficult themes which were forbidden in our Eastern European country, it will be a really good example to deal with memories, which the narration is always different, and it's not only one collective memory, even one country. So this is Jan was mentioned about war memories. This is exactly one thing which we should do together. Besides, if we think about some alternative way to sustain our network via web, it is also a good thing to solve many problems like health or health issues, or right now a humanitarian crisis, and so on and so on.
Yes, I mean, thank you. I agree basically with everything that you say. I mean, I think conceptually, I think it would be important to break out of these formats that are only bilateral. I mean, I enjoy German-Polish formats or German-Russian or whatever. But I think just like Alexandra said, we are good to have more formats which include, you know, all the countries of the region, or at least, you know, a fair share of them. By the way, also including possibly we have made very good experiences there, our colleagues from Israel, where there are also many people who have much to say about their legacy in the region, and they are sometimes a little bit forgotten as an important player and researcher in this field, since, you know, this was also an area of
it's beyond question. Totally agree. It's beyond question, of course. With
and the other pragmatic thing, of course, and we already mentioned this as well, is of course the help for the people who need our help now, and this can be students. I think this can be activists. This can be scholars. And sometimes we cannot even make a distinction, because we had, for example, people from Belarus at our center in Potsdam who we could support for a couple of months, who were historians of the ancient Jezioranski, and it was not because of their research that they got in trouble, but it was because of their activism against Lukashenko. So they were very interesting and professional historians. You know, it was not their historical work actually that had gotten them to trouble, but their politics. So I mean, I think there's a wide field of things that we can do, and there again, I think this should be done in a truly European way, because now these people are in Berlin or in Vilnius or in Warsaw and Lublin, and we should help them there, we should also try to get people in France or Italy or even maybe Spain interested in these issues and you know, make it a European thing to help these persecuted people from Belarus or Russia, because, you know, I mean, as a historian, I'm only dealing with the past and not with the future, but my prognosis will be that, you know, during the coming year, we will see many more of them. It is not over. We will see many more students. We will see many more activists. We will see many more colleagues who will come to Poland and Germany and Lithuania and Ukraine. There are a few professional programs at this point who deal with it in a way that they can at least partially continue their work while they were fired in their homelands.
I would also add migrants and refugees. And what you say, there is also optimistic, because I believe that in the same in German society, the same in Polish one, we have many people willing to help, but this all great actions are distracted. And right now we really need some agenda which will link this all together.
Thank you very much, Jan and Alexandra. I'm not seeing questions from our audience, but it's not a problem. They are not obligatory. I hope that you enjoyed. I mean, right now I'm addressing our audience, our online debate. For me, it was really interesting, and it was a great pleasure to moderate. Christmas are coming, so maybe in that case I would say Wesołych Świąt and Frohe Weihnachten in German, and Merry Christmas, of course, for our English-speaking viewers. And I think that right now we have to end our meeting. I think it was really something which this online debate, in my opinion, showed that we are not only dealing and discussing issues like pipelines and so on, but culture really matters. The legacy of history is important, even sometimes, in my opinion, more important than pipelines. So thank you very much. And again, Merry Christmas. Bye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me. And also Veseli Schwant and s Novim Godom.
Wszystkiego dobrego.
Okay.